UCO Wind Symphony concert tonight. My name is Danielle Herrington, and I am on the voice faculty here at UCO. I'm currently pursuing my doctorate at the University of Oklahoma, and when Brian Lamb invited me to be a guest artist for this performance of Labyrinth of Love, I was over the moon with excitement. Two things that I love, getting to learn and perform new American music, and also moving one step further towards my terminal degree, getting that title of doctor. So this concert will feature four different pieces, with Labyrinth of Love by composer Michael Daugherty being the final act two in the entirety. Since this is the piece I'm performing, I will be offering a lecture geared towards that tonight. Labyrinth of Love first premiered on June 15, 2012 in an orchestral version in Milwaukee, Wisconsin, while the wind version premiered a year later on October 6, 2013 by the University of Miami Frost. During this lecture, I will first offer brief histories of the selected poets and the subtext of their given poems, and follow with my revealed analyses of the various musical idioms in which Daugherty brought these words to life. My methodology for this talk included scholarly historical research in addition to my own original analysis of this score. Through the topics I cover in this lecture and my performance tonight, I contend that this symphonic song cycle is an opportunity for a soprano to truly embody a strikingly diverse array of female characters that call for a multitude of musical styles and vocal timbres. So let's dive into the text first. The brilliance of this work lies in the weaving of love stories. Following his regular compositional process, Daugherty draws inspiration from icons. In a recent interview with Robert Raines from 2015, Daugherty said this, quote, "I have composed music inspired by historical figures such as Rosa Parks, Abraham Lincoln, Jackie Kennedy, Elvis, Georgia O'Keeffe, by places such as Niagara Falls, Las Vegas, Route 66, and the Sunset Strip, and by icons such as Superman, the American Gothic, UFOs, and Mount Rushmore. Knowing my subject matter gives me an emotional framework and a reference point from which to begin the creative process." End quote. And Labyrinth of Love is no different. Though these poets may not be iconic like Superman or Jackie Kennedy, Daugherty uses these women's stories as a gateway to really explore the multifaceted topic of love. From the onset, he sets up the song cycle with a metaphoric poem that likens love's limitless options to the winding corridors of a labyrinth. And then from there, the whole cycle surveys the twists and turns of love. Love lost, love found, love longing. And Daugherty continues the exploration through each piece by selecting the words of eight notable female poets that represent a variety of historical ages and cultural contexts. Therefore, a work like this provides an intersection of topics. The modern sound world of a living classical composer paired with the aged words of women from the past. Beyond the musical, linguistic, and historical disciplines, when studying the human themes latent in these poems, the social constructs of the authors must also be accounted for. I like to believe that on the larger scale, this current musical discourse, that is, this musical work, Labyrinth of Love, is giving voice to women who fought for their voices to be heard within their own socio-political context. So with this in mind, I'll now speak about each poet and their selected poem. First, we start with Lady Mary Roth, whose dates are 1587 to 1653. She was a British poet noted for her sonnets and prose fiction, which pushed traditional boundaries of her age by writing secular love poetry and romances. And she was admired by contemporary male poets of the day. She did come from a literary family and was encouraged in her education and even had musical training in her upbringing. Her aunt was also a poet and is argued to be a large inspiration to Roth, since she published her own poems when many women did not have that opportunity nor dared to do so. Roth was forced into an arranged marriage to a knight who was friendly with King James I. While this did bring a prestige and privilege, it was also an unhappy emotional partnership, as their dispositions did not coincide. And her frustration with her given gender role and the lack of love, these really manifest in all of her poetry. Her collection, Pamphylia to Amphipius, which she wrote in 1613 and published in 1620, houses her most famous sonnet sequences. The main character female's name is Pamphylia, and it means all loving. And rather than addressing the lover at hand, Roth has the character address other topics like Cupid and night, grief, fortune, and time. This group of sonnet reveals Pamphylia's inner conflict. Critics differ in their interpretations, with some regarding Pamphylia as achieving an ascent to heavenly love, while others maintain that Pamphylia ends as she began, trapped in a fearful perplexity of what to do in love. And that sort of metaphor is all likened as she wanders through the corridors and the paths of the labyrinth, as she can't decide which lover to take or which place to be in her moment in time. In the quirky number 2, entitled Eros, you will hear the ancient text of Sappho. As a Greek female poet, only a handful of fragments from her original literary writings are extant. Her work is comparable to the intellectual dignity of Plato and is described by many scholars as incandescent and a marvel. Her overall output celebrates love as the highest human faculty while recognizing its complex nature. While little can be validated about Sappho's life in person, her literary works have helped her stand the test of time, being called the poetess, serving as the counterpart to Homer, the poet. In Fragment 47, which is the text for today, Sappho uses powerful and memorable images of trees being tossed and uprooted in a storm to declare that her heart has been shattered by love. Daugherty pairs this fragmented text with only wood blocks, and it makes for a very stark aural experience compared to the full orchestration of all of the other songs today. Number 3 comes from another British poet, Elizabeth Barrett Browning, who lived from 1806 to 1861. She was born to wealthy parents and grew up on a luxurious estate with individualized education. Though a delightful childhood, her life took a turn for the worse in her teens. She suffered from an ailment in the spine, and that gave her a lifelong disability. And while her education was then abruptly concluded when her brother was sent to boarding school and her tutors were then taken away. Then her mother died and her father lost all his money. It was quite a tragic story how her life evolved. And so desperate to make more of her life, she moved to London in 1835 and continued to vigorously pursue a literary career. In 1844, she began a 20-month correspondence with the playwright Robert Browning, who would eventually become her husband. Her courtship to Robert inspired Elizabeth's 44 Petrarchan sonnets, recognized as one of the finest sonnet sequences ever published in English. This series is called Sonnets from the Portuguese, and number 7 of this is what you will hear today. Though Robert valued his privacy, when Elizabeth showed him these sonnets that were inspired by their relationship, he felt the quality of these works demanded their publication. And so they first appeared in Browning's 1850 edition of Poems. And in order to try to sort of hide how it connected personally to their love, she omitted Sonnet 42, and she also used a title that implied that they were translations, though they were not. So they weren't actually originally in Portuguese. Actually, the title shows us and confirms that it really was their relationship that inspired it, because Robert loved one of her poems that she had written a decade before that talked about a dying woman who was in love with an exiled Portuguese courtier. So it kind of deepens that connection. These sonnets were also revolutionary because she makes the speaker a woman, which breaks from Petrarchan conventions. They directly express female desire, and I find this part particularly important when embodying this character, since it comes directly from the female perspective and it intensifies the dramatic personal content that Browning was embedding within it. In this number, Daugherty includes a solo trumpet, and I have decided to interpret this trumpet as Robert, as if it was her husband. Like the voice of the poet when I'm singing is sort of dialoguing with the trumpet back and forth in the piece. So I'm sort of Elizabeth and the trumpet is Robert. He also sets this piece polytonally, meaning that while the instruments play in one key, the singer is often dissonant against it in a different key. At one point, There's a moment where the symphony is separated into different sections, and one section is playing in A flat, another is playing in A natural, just a half step higher, and the singer atop me is singing in the key of G major. So it creates a very jarring effect, and it's quite difficult to do as well. But I believe that this clash of tonality really emphasizes the speaker's unrest in the poetry. Number four, If I May Have It When It's Dead, is a text by American writer Emily Dickinson, who lived from 1830 to 1886. Following in the footsteps of Elizabeth Barrett Browning, Dickinson crafted a new type of persona for the first person, and she strove to make the abstract tangible. She was raised in Massachusetts with a lawyer for a father and a passive mother. Dickinson relished her schooling at Amherst Academy and later seminary. She openly detested the passive role of wife that was expected during her social circumstances, and she never married. Between 1850 and 65, she wrote 1,100 poems, yet not many of them were published, and she wasn't able to secure the rights. The scholar Sarah Ann Wider said this about Dickinson, quote, "Throughout her life, Dickinson looked for unexpected connections between individuals, between ideas and images, between the knowledge one has and the knowledge one wants. Her final written words suggest the power she imagined could rest within her hands." And within the poem Daugherty set to music for this cycle, Dickinson's female figure ironically accepts the fate that she can finally be with the one she loves, but only after he's dead. It's a little turn there, gave away the ending. So, in the fifth song, Daugherty uses a translation of Juana Inés de la Cruz's poem entitled Traigo Conmigo un Cuidado, I Bring With Me Care. De la Cruz was one of the most celebrated Baroque playwrights and poets in the Spanish colonies, now Mexico. She wrote both religious and secular plays, with almost all of her works being impressively published during her life. She always had a thirst for knowledge and was always pursuing education, which was not widely accepted. And her beauty and her brains ended up winning her a place in court, but she felt she was being called to a religious life. And she, in 1668, left the court to become a nun at St. Jerome. And she wanted to really pursue and dedicate her life to being a lyric poet. In the poem that is musically set here, De la Cruz expresses her dissatisfaction with the lack of communication in a divine relationship. As a nun, she has rejected all kinds of human love in favor of one legitimate love, God. In a critique of this poem, scholar Arthur Terry described it like this: "The problem arises when her spiritual desires become overlaid with human expectations. Her suffering comes about because she wishes God to return her love, though she regards this as a human weakness. It seems what she really fears is that the purity of her love for God will be harmed by an excessively human idea of correspondence." To musically depict this spiritual struggle, Daugherty calls for an unclear tonal center by employing cluster chords, many, many, many notes sort of smashed together. And that's all happening in the higher range, while underneath we have open fifths. And this is without any sort of defined third. This obscures whether we have a major or minor tonality and really creates an elusive, ambiguous tonal quality. Also, this poem is the only one that goes outside of the realm of romantic love. Number six is probably the most unique, for its text derives from a movie script. In this song, I portray the famed actress Elizabeth Taylor. Starting in 1942 and going through the 1970s, Taylor starred in dozens of Hollywood films. In 1963, a defining year for her, she met her off and on again husband, Richard Burton, while filming Cleopatra. They were married from 1964 to 1974, broke up, got back together from 1975 to 1976, and then split up for good. So since it did not work out long-term for them, she actually, in her life, was married to 8 different men. Daugherty sourced the words sung today from Taylor's various movies with Burton. The beginning lyrics actually come from the opening of the VIP trailer from 1967. The second stanza is from Cleopatra, And the third stanza and the lyric, sad, 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 all come from Who's Afraid of Virginia Woolf, where Taylor plays an alcoholic, crazed wife. I've used this as inspiration when playing her today, going for more of this sort of confused state, almost as if she can't decide whether she's being herself or the characters that she plays alongside her husband on screen. The second to last piece, O Come to Me in Dreams, My Love, was written by Mary Shelley, whose dates are 1797 to 1851. At first mention, you may recognize Shelley's name in conjunction with her most famous work, the sci-fi gothic novel, Frankenstein. Less talked about is her love life, which was quite scandalous. As a teenager, she actually had an affair with the famous poet, Percy Shelley. Their short-lived relationship was quite a rocky one. She had three miscarriages, and this put her into a deep depression, and then Percy ended up dying suddenly in a boat accident. Now, there's conjecture that the poem you'll hear today is actually a personal plea from Mary to Percy, as if she's asking him to return again and rekindle the love that they had before all the tragedy had set in their lives. And finally, to conclude the poetry discussion, the final song consists of a short poem written by living Canadian poet Anne Carson. Carson's poetry is considered postmodern, and she likes to work with concrete details and experienced events. Today we'll be hearing a minuscule odd paragraph from the collection entitled Short Talks, which appears in the second section of her book Plain Water from 1995. A direct quote from Carson, she describes their purpose. I will do anything to avoid boredom. It is the task of a lifetime. You can never know enough, never work enough, never use the infinitives and the participles oddly enough. Short talks, for example, consists of brief paragraphs that have the intention of making the reader slip out of rational thought to construct an instance of nature gradually without the boredom of story. These prose pieces are not only about being in a moment, but also creating the moment, moment by moment. So that gives you a sense of what this character's like. This is a very perfect piece, and a really interesting piece of material for a symphonic composer to work with as a creative impetus for a very repetitive and minimalist musical moment. Daugherty couples this abstract concept with a whole tone scale and his signature layering technique, which I'll speak more about in the next section. In many of the published interviews with Daugherty, he stresses how he seeks emotional balance between tragedy and comedy. To accomplish this, he has learned from the pacing and the timing found in good theater. I believe this mindfulness definitely played into the extreme contrast of women he chose for Labyrinth and the appropriate pacing between their varied emotional states. Moreover, Daugherty aptly crafted vastly different stylistic musical sound worlds in order to successfully realize these differing expressive modes. With that in mind, let's now jump into my musical examination. I will first address vocal timbre, then minimalism, and conclude briefly by highlighting his signature compositional techniques. An interesting aspect of performing these songs has to do with the way in which I change the quality of and manipulate my voice for stylistic needs. Because Daugherty is known for his fusion of style in concert music, so rather than strictly sticking to classical forms or a systematized 20th century mode of composition, he really draws on his musical upbringing, where he played in rock bands and jazz combos and even in the bugle corps. Later in his formal training, he experimented with digital music at IRCOM with Berio and Boulez in Paris during the early 80s, and then he even went on to train at Yale. So he really does have such a diverse musical background, and that influences his writing. In a direct quote from Daugherty, he said, "In our culture, we limit ourselves. Although we started out with three television stations, we now have 55, yet they are categorized into different kinds of entertainment. An artist should avoid labels and be spontaneous. The challenge for today's artist is to not become trapped in categories, so then he is free to use his imagination. Often, when an artist or a composer writes about what he feels, it can be easily dismissed as naive. Art is a combination of writing about what one feels and then stepping back and critiquing and analyzing it." And I think this really manifests in this song cycle, Labyrinth of Love. He doesn't write as much for the voice As of now, his output only includes 8 pieces with vocal production in comparison to his total output that includes over 110 compositions. And I have to say, for the most part, he really does write quite idiomatically for the voice, being a predominantly instrumental composer. With that in mind, though, there are a lot of changes that he asks for in terms of vocal quality that I find that a more strictly classical composer doesn't often request. Usually, if I sing something from opera, I will sing with a full, vibrant production and no microphone. If I sing something musical theater, I would adhere to those particular styles, and it usually calls for a mic. And the same thing with commercial music. Yet Daugherty asked the soprano in this work to really embrace various singing styles in order to match with his curated sound worlds. For instance, in number 7, Daugherty creates this 60s, 70s, easygoing rock vibe through a straightforward 4-chord harmonic progression in E minor. To match this vocally, he actually prints "A la Dusty Springfield" for the vocalist in the score. I have listened to many of her songs for inspiration, but what Daugherty wrote is actually quite a bit higher in tessitura and range, so it's not able to be quite as belty as Springfield or that really true pop style. But that being said, I definitely alter the timbre of my voice to be more soulful and have a lot less vibrato so that it fits into sort of a pop style within the classical idiom. Another area where he asks for vocal change is in the song number 6, in which I embody Elizabeth Taylor. And that one is particularly interesting because he asks for a lot of Baroque style concepts. From my own scholarly pursuits, I don't subscribe to the camp that believes Baroque style singing should be straight tone with no vibration. So I did not make that choice. However, there are compositional elements that are Baroque in this piece. We have a 3-2 stately meter that suggests it is a chaconne, a few trills and ornaments in the vocal line, and then the solo instrument is an English horn. And this is particularly Baroque because the woodwind timbre of an oboe actually generates this desired affect, as we call it in the Baroque world, of sadness. So I went for a more full-bodied operatic sound that you won't hear in all of the pieces. Like take number 4, for instance, the Emily Dickinson poem. It has a pop rock syncopated rhythm that calls for strength on beats 2 and 4, as well as lower neighbor blues notes that the ensemble will play in their major melodic motive. Drawing on this sort of funky vibe, I chose a vocal timbre with much less vibrato. It comes off of the voice a lot too, which is something we don't regularly do in classical singing. Usually in classical singing that's unamplified, it really requires the singer to stay on their voice at all times for projection and alignment and legato. But I don't do that in all of this set, only sometimes. Sorry, teacher. While learning and analyzing this cycle, it became evident that Daugherty employs elements of minimalism in his music. This is a common technique first used by composers in the 1960s, like Terry Riley and Philip Glass, and of course John Adams in his operas. Minimalism relies heavily on repetition and heavy pulsations. Rhythmically, songs number 1, 2, 5, and 8 all have a driving pulse that compel the pieces forward, sort of like a foot on a gas pedal. But it is the textual repetitions that clearly create a type of minimalist monotony for the listener. Though he repeats certain lines of the poems throughout, the pattern I distinguish occurs at the end of every single song. This is a bit of a laundry list, so bear with me. And number 1, he starts off slow by repeating the lines "The Thread of Life, Love" twice. In number 2, he repeats the spoken line "sa, sa, sa" 4 times at the end. In number 3, you'll hear the word "grief" 8 times, with multiple melodic melismas painting the word distinctly for each iteration. In number 4, he repeats the line "for death was that" 5 times, and "this is thee" 3 times. Number 5 by far takes the cake for minimalism at the end, as the text "is repent and disallow it" is emphasized through a repetition of 14 times. That one was hard to memorize. I believe that this musical choice stresses the emotional context of the confident, crazed singer who will not concede to human weakness. In number 6, he restates "sad" 4 times to close the song. And in number 7, "kiss" is sung 5 times at the conclusion. And finally, number 8 overall is the most minimalist piece in its entirety. Not only do the lyrics "let's buy it" and "what a bargain" happen 7 times to finish the piece, but the text, "well, you know that could be true love," is recited in various fragments 40 times within the duration of the song, in addition to other lyrics being repeated many times. Not only is the text treated minimalistically, but also tonality is economical. Daugherty utilized a whole tone scale throughout, and this creates complexity when he also employs his layering technique midway. And this is when the voice and the symphony are polyphonic, or at odds with each other, competing melodically for your ear. He creates this stretto that has the instruments imitating in the whole tone passage after the voice has entered. And as you can imagine, this really is particularly difficult for maintaining intonation and proper scale. And the tonality really does feel a bit at odds in these highly polyphonic sections. However, I really like to think this is a very cacophonous effect, and that it's achieved because he really wants to bring the cycle to a close with a lot of energy and verve. Beyond the musical elements discussed thus far, like rock rhythms and minimalism and his layering technique, Daugherty is known for developing motives and employing complex polyrhythms. The first song of this cycle demonstrates his use of motives. He uses a rhythmic motive of a quarter note and 2/8 notes, 42 times. And this rhythmic motive is passed between the voice and the symphony. Additionally, it appears many times with a melodic motive that always has a leap between a minor six, and it sequences throughout. So, tonight, with this performance, I will be joining the other six sopranos who have sang this piece professionally in its 8 short years of existence. I'm so honored and privileged to join these other strong women embodying these timeless female figures set captively by Daugherty in his song cycle, Labyrinth of Love. In Daugherty's original program notes, he succinctly described this song cycle saying, "The text I have selected and this musical landscape I have created is full of bitterness, desire, longing, ecstasy, irony, tenderness, despair, hope, sadness, and humor." And with that, I hope you'll be plunged into these emotional atmospheres in the upcoming concert.